So our first part will be going through some of the eukaryotic protein coding gene sequences and the corresponding GenBank records. And Rag1 is our example. This is showing the Takufugu gene, and there are four exons for this gene in the pufferfish. The first exon is a non-coding exon. It has the 5' UTR untranslated region. Then it's followed by an intron, and then there are additional exons for the rest of the gene. The second and fourth exons are both coding and non-coding. I once had a submitter who thought that exons were only coding, and it really depends on your organism and on the gene. But in the pufferfish, of the four exons for this gene, only one exon is only coding. If we continue to look at Rag1 sequences, so the pufferfish gene is 5146 bases long, and showing on the screen are some other GenBank accessions. And it turns out that most people who use Rag1 as a molecular marker, they only determine the sequence for part of exon 4. So the sequences that they obtain from the sequencing technology are 5' and 3' partial, and they are approximately 1,400 bases long. Please recognize that 5' and 3' partial says nothing about whether it's untranslated. So you want to make sure that you keep straight the 5' and 3' nature of your sequence data. Let's look at the GenBank record. And there is a link on the page that will give you more information about the individual fields in a GenBank display format as shown on the screen. Primarily, there are three parts. There is the top part shown here in pink, the next part which is outlined in red, and then the blue part, and I'll just go through that in a moment. So the top part is the part that describes the study, the organism, the taxonomic information, the references, and it gives you the definition and the accession number. The bottom section, which we have just a small part shown here at the bottom of the screen, is the actual sequence, whether it's DNA or RNA, and it has numbered rows, and it is in groups of 60. Nucleotides for each row. If we look at the features section, there is source information. For this particular GenBank record, we only have the organism name, but this is where you would include the culture collection or the drain or other isolate information. And then we have the annotated gene and other features. Sometimes people look at a GenBank record and they see other information that is included in the CDS section of the GenBank display record, and they add this information in their data submission. You should not do this. This information is provided by GenBank and NCBI staff, and the translation is what will be done by the submission tool when you add the CDS feature. You only need to worry about the specific features, namely the gene, messenger RNA, and CDS feature when you do your data submission. So if we look at the feature section in a little bit more detail, it's important that you indicate with the correct partial indicator, whether it is 5' or 3' partial. And when you look at the graphic representation of the Rag1 gene, this record, again, the first base, and then it is 1439 bases long, and it is 5' and 3' incomplete. Sometimes submitters think that they need to give coordinates that are related to the gene itself or to the chromosome, the genomic piece of DNA, but you should always provide your information for the features as they are on your sequence. Whatever length your sequence is, that should be the total number of bases included in the features that you are adding at the time of your submission. So let's look at beta-tubulin as another example from this fungus. This is a member of the tubulin family, and it has 7 exons. And in this organism, none of the exons include untranslated regions. So all of the exons in this particular organism for this gene are coding. I want to focus in on one specific splice site, and this is the crux of the matter of eukaryotic nuclear genes. So in the DNA sequence, and this gene is on the plus strand, introns start with a GT that is called the splice donor site or splice donor pair, and introns end with an AG that is called the splice acceptor pair. So 5 prime is usually GT, 3 prime is AT. Now, this is not the only donor acceptor pair. There are some others, but predominantly in eukaryotic genes, it is GTAG. So if you indicate your coding region such that it includes this G, you will get an error in some of the submission tools, but it will be biologically incorrect. And GenBank staff will ask you to correct it. Because it's not biologically valid. So the GTAG pairs are something that you want to pay especially attention to when you are submitting data that is protein coding and that has exons and introns. Here's some more examples of beta-tubulin sequences. And most of the beta-tubulin sequences that are submitted, again, are 5 prime and 3 prime partial sequences. Here we have some GenBank accessions shown on the screen, and they cover several different exons. So we're going to have several pieces or several parts of our coding regions that we need to include in our CDS feature. This is a genomic scaffold. This is a specific GenBank accession number that I'm showing again for the exons. But this piece, again, this KP189336 accession number, it starts at base 1. It's 5 prime partial, so it has the less than sign. And it is 675 nucleotides long, so it has the greater than sign to indicate it's 3 prime partial. And then we determined the individual nucleotide numbers for this sequence for each part of the coding region. And that's what we will need to add in our CDS feature. So we have a specific submitter who has written to us. They have 2 different data sets, one for TEF1A and one for beta-tubulin or TUB2. And they've already identified some GenBank records that are similar to their data sets. So they're asking for help. And the important thing to recognize is to understand whether the person doesn't know how to determine the CDS locations, or she may know them, but she doesn't know how to add the information in the submission tool.